unpack the whole cultivation process, let's take a moment to look at spawn, and also clarify a common misunderstanding with beginner mycologists, namely, the difference between spawn and spores. So, when we talked earlier about the life cycle of a mushroom-producing fungus, we mentioned the stage where those mushrooms release spores. And we talked about how, when one of those spores lands on an appropriate material, it can germinate and form a hypha. And when two compatible hyphae meet, they join, share DNA, and then become mycelium. From this point, the mycelium can go on to produce its own mushrooms, which release spores, and then the whole process begins again. This is the only method for mushroom-producing fungi to sexually reproduce. This type of reproduction allows fungi to reshuffle their DNA, which increases genetic diversity and makes the whole species more resistant to disease or changes in the environment. What we haven't discussed yet is that while most fungi can use spores as a means of reproduction, it's pretty fraught, as they need perfect conditions to grow and thrive. Incredibly, fungi have found another way to reproduce. In fact, the most common way they reproduce is simply through fragmentation of the mycelium. A small part of mycelium gets broken off and then grows into a new separate fungus. This natural tissue culture, or cloning, often happens in nature. Say there's a rotting tree completely infused with mycelium. A branch falls off and lands in a river and floats along until it runs into a log jam. When the flood is over and the water level recedes again, that mycelium in the branch grows out into any of the wood it's touching and colonizes it. Or maybe a bird is digging in soil that has a fungus growing through it. A little tiny bit of mycelium may be picked up on its feet, carried somewhere else where it can continue to grow. For us home cultivators, this tissue culture method of reproduction is much easier to use than using spores. By using tissue culture, we're replicating that exact same fungi, which means our resulting mushrooms will be clones of their mother, which is useful when you're trying to grow great mushrooms with a consistent result. The other advantage of replicating using mycelium rather than spores is that the mycelium has a massive head start. It doesn't need to go through the tricky and hazardous first stages of germination and growth like spores do. It can just get going, outcompete any competitors and run through its substrate. Adding to all this, propagating with mycelium is far less likely to result in contamination from other organisms, which means a higher rate of success for you. Expert cultivators that do use spores to breed new varieties almost always use a lab environment to ensure success. So for these reasons and more, most mushroom cultivation is done through tissue culture, taking small amounts of mycelium and transferring it into a new food source for it to grow and produce a lot more mycelium. And that's going to be the technique that we're going to focus on in this course. Most of the time, when we propagate through tissue culture, we use mycelium growing on a material that has been chosen to have the optimal properties for success. It's got a name very similar to the word spore, but it's completely different. It's called spawn, S-P-A-W-N. To add to the confusion, spawn is often mycelium growing on grain, which are the seeds of grasses. So you'll sometimes hear spawn called mushroom seeds, which is not very helpful because, well, fungi don't have seeds. The grass seeds are just the food or substrate our mycelium is growing on. Okay, so let's recap for a sec. Spawn is mycelium which has been grown on some sort of substrate, often grain, for the sole purpose of inoculating more substrate. A bag of spawn is not intended to directly grow mushrooms itself. It's a bag of inoculant. That's what the word spawn means. A bag of potential, if you like. So, spawn comes in all different types. We can have dowel spawn grown on little wooden dowels for log cultivation. You can have sawdust spawn grown on sawdust, or you can even have popcorn spawn grown on popping corn. For grain spawn, the most common grains used are wheat, barley, or millet. This is a bag of grain spawn that we purchased from a commercial supplier. If you look closely, you can see the grain, in this case their secret mix of grass seeds, and the white fuzzy stuff, which is the mycelium growing through the grain. So when we use spawn to inoculate a substrate, we're doing a type of tissue culture propagation. We use our bag of grain spawn by breaking it up and distributing through our prepared bulk substrate. Now there's thousands of little points of inoculation where each grain of spawn touches the substrate. Each little piece of mycelium will explore outwards, running through the substrate, meeting up with its peers until it reforms into a single organism once again. It's quite magical. So, hopefully that clears things up for you. Spawn is very different from spores. While we don't cover the use of spores to grow mushrooms in this course, there is a rather beautiful process you can play with to get to know spores better. Why not try making a spore print? First, let's take a quick look at the parts of a mushroom. With so many different varieties, not all mushrooms have all the same features, but your shiitakes and even your oyster mushrooms share a lot in common with this Swiss brown mushroom. At the top, we have the cap, under which we'll find the gills, or in some cases, pores. Hidden in the gills or pores of the mushroom are tens of billions of microscopic spores. The cap and spores are kept off the ground, or whatever it's growing out of, by the stem or stipe. In some species, you'll see a ring, which is the remnant of the veil that covered the gills. You can see the veil intact on smaller mushrooms. You can download a PDF below with the common and proper names of all the features, including the different cap shapes and gill attachments, if you want more detail. So this mushroom I'm holding and waving around, I'm releasing thousands of microscopic spores into the air all around me, but we can't see them. Or can we? Let's make a spore print to take a closer look. We're going to take a mushroom and cut off its stipe right down to the gills and place it gill side down on some paper. Cover it with a bowl or glass, and leave it overnight. And when you gently pick up the mushroom in the morning, you'll find a beautiful spore print left behind. Have a look at this one. If your mushroom has white gills, try it on black paper. If its gills are brown, try it on white paper. Kitchen foil works for any color. Or if you really want to get tricky, try it on a small sheet of glass, like this. While you're not likely to have success using spore prints to grow mycelium, the air and the paper or glass are probably contaminated. You can use it to help identify which species of mushroom you've found on your morning walk. Each species has its own particular colour of spore print, and sometimes it's not the colour you'd imagine from the way the gills look. If you want to keep this and display it as art, use a little fixative or hairspray to make it a permanent print. Okay, now you're super clear on what spawn is and how it differs from spores. You're also clear on why we use spawn as our preferred inoculation method. It really helps you have great success, right from the get-go. If you've got any questions, comment below and we can help. Next up, it's time to look at the whole mushroom cultivation process in detail.